Good morning, everyone. I want to say welcome to a wonderful church family. And we have a visitor with us this morning. I'm going to center him out. He'll probably kill me. He's my brother, Jack. He happened to be in the area and he's visiting. If there are any other visitors with us, we extend to you a very warm welcome. And we have a special welcome for Pastor Tirsa and his wife Brenda. It's great to have them back again this week. And a little later in the service, Pastor Tirsa will be conducting a prayer time and of course bringing the message. And I'm sure we're all looking forward to that. I know I am. Let's just thank the Lord. Father, we do thank you that we can gather together in your name and worship you this morning. Lord, we do thank you for the church family here, a loving, caring, sharing church family. We're thankful. Father, we just pray that your Holy Spirit will fill us and touch our hearts with the love of Jesus. And open our minds that we may be open and receptive to the message from your word this morning. Thank you once again in Jesus' name. Amen. Could you stand with us, please, as we sing, "I Will Enter His Gates"? I will enter. This next song is found in the Christian Praise hymn book that we sometimes use when we have the soup and sing night. It's a great song. Some people call it, well, the real title is "We Are Happy Today." I like to call it "It's Good to Be Here." But anyway, I think we're covered this morning either way, don't you think? And it's also, if you've ever been to Ivanhoe Camp, this would be the song that you would hear on the opening Friday night service. Always sang this. So here we go.
We are happy. Lord God. God is so good.
really great reports, praise the Lord report. And we'll start with Cindy. Cindy's here this morning, and a little later she's going to do an announcement as well. And then I was talking to Sue Sharp yesterday, and Bob is really coming along well. She said he's doing really well. He's now walking with a cane and just about ready to go on solid food. So praise the Lord for that. He's still on layer six or level six, 620, and that was designated as the COVID floor for a long time, but Sue says that's lifted. If anybody would like to visit, 620.
And then what else do we have?
Oh, there's, I want to forget this one. Carol Levine gave this one. Just bear with me, I'll have it in a second here. Okay. In the month of September, we are trying something different with the prayer requests in the bulletin. So the format is going to look a little different. Hopefully the format changes. We'll make it easier to read and understand.
Okay.
And, well, you know, people who are doing the bulletin now, that effort and time, people who have done it in the past, we thank them from the depths of my heart, all of them. Thank you. I don't know, does anybody have any further announcements this morning? Jane.
There's a couple that has been coming here maybe 5 or 6 times, and they would sit here, and they're in Elba, and they live near me. So I called them this week. I haven't seen you in church for a while. Are you okay? There he is in the hospital with cancer, and it doesn't look very good.
Gene, my hearing's not the greatest. Can you give her a little more volume?
Larry Wilson.
Okay.
They've been coming here for a while, and they haven't been the last 2 or 3 Sundays, so I called them because they live near me. And Larry is in the hospital with cancer, and it doesn't look good.
Oh, good response. Larry Wilson?
Larry
Wilson. Pastor Tursa, whoops, do you have that, Larry Wilson? Yeah, I think we're ready for prayer time, and Pastor Tursa will come and conduct the prayer time.
As we come to the Lord in prayer, why don't we ourselves just quiet ourselves, close our eyes, and each of us just pray what the Lord has placed on our heart. And then I will conclude with a prayer. Just take a few moments. Come to the Lord.
Yeah.
Talk with him. Hear what he's saying. Tell him what's on your heart. God, hear the prayers of these, your people, your church. There's so many things going on personally and corporately as a church and in our world. It's hard at times. Life is often very difficult. But God, you do not leave us. You've not forsaken us. You are here. Your will be done. We pray, Lord, for the needs of the church, the leadership transition as they seek.
Yes.
Your will for a new pastor. Lord, you already know who that is. We just pray they'll come together in your timing. Give those who are doing the work encouragement and guidance. We pray for the Free Methodist Church in Canada and the transition it's going through with its leadership. We pray for our land. From sea to sea. Pray for our world, what's happening in the Middle East, in Europe. Lord, there's so many things going on. Children going back to school and all the families and all that hustle and bustle of getting that together and going in a new routine. Lord, bless our families. Bless our children. Bless our grandchildren. Father, for those who are sick, for those who have recovered, we think of Bob Leonard. We think of Bob Sharp. We think of the name Larry Wilson that was shared. And earlier, I heard that Dan Albin is having a bypass tomorrow. Be with him and his family, each of them, Lord.
Yes.
You know what they need. You are the healer. We pray for mercy. We pray for grace in this time. God, we love you. Thank you that we could come. Thank you we could be here. Could we pray the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory.
Thank you, Pastor Peter. In the garden.
I come to the garden.
Tells me I am his.
song. You are my all in all.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are my
retirement. It's something that we work very hard for, and I'm sure someone else has thanked you all, but truly everyone has come together to make that a great occasion for Pastor Rodney, and I think it was a beautiful send-off for him, so thank you for that. The second thing is, I just wanted you to know, as a board, we are working on the transition. There's a lot of things that are happening in the background, and it's not fallen through the cracks, it is working. Mary Sharp has stepped in to fill in for Bob Sharp while he's in the hospital, so the team is still gonna work on things. we have asked for an interim pastor, so we're working on that as well. So we just wanted you to know that we are working, things are happening, and we are praying diligently that God brings the right person for us to fill in. There's going to be a few pastors that are coming that could be prospective interim pastors, so once that happens, we'll certainly let you know. And then finally, a thank you from me, from our family.
For the love and the support you all gave to my family during my husband's transition home time. So for that, I'm eternally grateful. And just to let you know how God works, the prayers that you've prayed were totally answered. Bob had no pain, zero pain in his end days, even though it was not a nice time for him. He did not have any pain. So for that, we are so grateful for the miracle that you prayed that that would be answered. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Cindy. You are loved. I really enjoy singing this song, or trying to sing this song. It's a fun song, and I would invite you to sing the chorus with us. They will be projected, and you have to, just with this song, if you could, just let your imagination wander a little bit when it comes to the story of Jesus walking on the water. Did you get it right? But the rest of it's great.
Let's all go down by the river. There's a man, he's walking on the water. Come along with me.
Was there anyone whose toe wasn't tapping?
Wasn't that wonderful? Yes, that man, that's why we're here. Jesus, yes. That's what has brought us together. That's what brings us together. That's what life is for, to come to Jesus. And let me just pray before we begin here again. Father, what a privilege to be here with these people, your people. And Father, I just pray now as we come to your word, that you will speak, that we will hear, that we will listen, and that you will have a word for each of us. Come, Holy Spirit, you are here. Fill this place in power. May we understand and just come to find peace in life. Thank you, Jesus. You are the man who can walk on water and so much more. Come now, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
If you have your Bibles, I'd like you to open to 1 Peter. Would you look at 1 Peter chapter 5? And I'm reading the first 7 verses there. And I'm sorry because I'm not from your church. I have a New King James Version. I'm sorry. So if you use the NIV or something else, but you can follow along. So chapter 5, the first 7 verses. The elders who are among you, I exhort, I who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. Shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving his overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly, nor as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. Likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. Yes, all of you, be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud. He gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. I want to begin with a question. Who in your circle of life, either family or friends or others, would you consider to have lived a significant life? Think about it. Who have you known over the years? Who do you know who you would believe has lived a significant life? Those that perhaps have influenced you, have encouraged you, have been an example to you. Someone that you may have looked up to. I know in my life, it was in my first church in Northern Ontario, a little town called New Lisker. And there's 3 towns there. They've called it something else. You know, they keep changing the names of cities. Doesn't that get annoying sometimes? And anyways, it's not called that anymore. And he was in my first church. I met a man. His name was Ron. And he was quite a few years senior to me. But as I got to know Ron, he was a man of God. He knew the scripture like no one. I never went to seminary or anything, but he knew the scriptures. He could challenge me. And I was to be his pastor, but I felt he was my pastor. And a wonderful, godly man. And I could see in him. He was under the, I think he came to the Lord when China closed and the missionaries came home. He was in a group that befriended him, and he grew with them. And I know that even in his last years, he was looking after them as they got older. They were women that came back from the mission field. And this was the group. Anyways, he was a person that I would call lived a significant life. You could see it, how people relate to him, how he walked in the community, and how he conducted himself. On an international level, I personally would think of Billy Graham, who had a significant life. And I remember being able to go to one of his events in Toronto, and I have a whole story I can tell you about that, but I won't. but he lived a life that I would say was significant. I'm not saying perfect, but significant when I think of people. How do you live a significant life? There's the question. How do we live a significant life? How do we live the kind of life that God would want each of us to live? And we're all different, we're all individuals, but how does God want us to live? And would that be a significant life? Sure it would. What would it look like, however? You know, at the end of his life, Jesus was able to say in a prayer the night before he died on the cross, he prayed in John 17:4, he said, "I have glorified you on the earth," he's speaking to his Father, "I have finished the work which you have given me to do. I have finished the work you have given me to do." What a wonderful prayer. What a wonderful thing to be able to say. Even when he was on the cross with his last dying breath, Jesus was able to say, "It is done. It is complete. It is finished." It looked like to everyone it was a failure, but it was a success. Wouldn't you like to end your life that way? With a real sense, I finished it. I did what God had called me to do. Significant living happens, firstly, when you start serving. Matthew 23:11. "The greatest among you will be your servant." The greatest among you will be your servant. You know, that's pretty simple, isn't it? It's clear to the point. The problem, however, is I think that in our society, we don't remember or understand what a servant is, or as it was written in the day of our scripture. If I'm going to be the greatest, I have to be a servant. If you really want to have a significant life, one of the questions you have to ask yourself is, where can my life have the most impact? How can I make the best use of my time? And friends, even if you are sitting and standing near the end of your life, it's never too late to still serve. Have you looked back over your life and seen times when you've made changes? Have you made changes in your life? I'm sure you have. You know what I've discovered? That the older you get, it seems you figure out, I don't think I was right on that aspect of things. I think I'm going to change. I mean, this, when we're young, we're stiff, we have all the answers and we know. But as you get older, you realize how much you don't know. Isn't that true? You don't realize how much you don't know. And we turn to God, don't we? God, help me. God, help me. Show me. But to be a servant, the best and greatest impact that any person can have in this life is to impact another person's life for good. By being a servant. You know, even the greatest buildings and the greatest bridges that we've ever built someday are going to crumble. But people will last forever. Should we not be pouring our lives into others and serving others? Getting the focus off ourselves and onto others. Jesus said the greatest way to impact another person is by serving. And this fits into every situation in our life, no matter what we're doing, no matter where you are, no matter what situation you face. Husbands and wives, if you want to become the greatest husband or wife, become a servant to the other. That's how it works. Employers, managers, leaders, or those who are workers and followers, to be great is to have a life of significance means to serve. Especially those who are young who say, "I want to have a great impact in this world," Jesus says, "Be a servant." What a blessing to live your whole life in service. But let me remind you that a servant always places themselves last. The servant always puts others first. We don't live in a day like that, do we? Not at all. It's very opposite. Me, 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 me.
Yes. Amen.
to those of us who are old, and I see myself in that category. I know you might look at me and think I'm young, but I feel I'm getting old. And there, even to those of us who are at that place in life, you know, we can still serve. In 1 Peter chapter 5, is talking to the people who were servants in the church. They were leaders, but they were servants too. And he's giving them advice about serving, and advice about what he had learned from Jesus about serving. And it's a great advice to anyone who's seeking to influence others and to live a significant life. Lord, what would you have for me to do in the days that I have left? And I can hear him say, serve others. You see, servants, first of all, will choose desire over duty. This is what Peter is saying in verse 2. We will choose as a servant, you will choose desire over duty. Serve as overseers, not because you must, but because you are willing. As God wants you to be, not greedy for money, but eager to serve. You see, duty doesn't work to impact other people, but desire and willingness will impact other people. If we want to have a significant impact on others, we have to change all those things in our lives that are shoulds, the things we should do. We have to change it to we want to do it. We desire to do it. Four words that will never change the world: if I have to. If I have to. That'll never change the world. I'll do it if I have to. Remember your kids? If you had children, when you were a child, do I have to? Right? It takes desire to change the world. Can you imagine Columbus talking to the Queen of Spain, who says, I want you to go to the other side of the world. I want you to find a new land or a new passage to China. And he says, do I have to? I'm going to move this because I'm going to keep hitting it. Excuse me. My hands fly too much when I preach. Can you imagine Columbus saying, do I have to? No, no, no. He had a desire. He had a burning desire. And he accomplished. Can you imagine Neil Armstrong getting ready to step onto the moon? And he calls back to Mission Control, do I have to? Or David in the battlefield facing Goliath. Can you imagine looking at that great Goliath, fighting him and defeating him if he had gone into it with a do I have to attitude? No, he wanted to, and he knew that God was with him. You see, desire is what makes the difference in life. The ability to say, I want to do this. Some of you may be feeling very trapped in the have-tos in your life. For many, life is about duty. I have to do this, I have to do that. It can be in our relationships, it can be in the life of the church, and it can wear us down. Often we face this kind of situation in our life, and the only viable option that we see, or the only way of escape that we see, or the only way to get out, is to change our circumstances when we're in something that is duty and we have to, and it doesn't work for us. And so people will leave relationships. They will change jobs. They will leave even the church or go to another. But let me give you another option today that I believe the Lord is challenging us here. Instead of changing your circumstance, consider changing your heart. Consider changing your heart. Changing all those duties and responsibilities into opportunities. Changing your heart. This is the key. Serve not because you must, but because you are willing. Willingness is so important in our lives. And beside the word willing, you need to put the word energy. Because energy comes from what we willingly want to do. Think about it. Not from what we have to do, but from what we want to do. Think of all the families that will get up in the weeest hours of the morning on a Sunday and take their kids to a ball game, to a sporting event, and they have to get up much earlier than they do through the week, and they have to spend lots of money to get their kids into all of this stuff. But it all happens. Why? They want to. They want this for their kids. Coming to church too early in the morning. Right? At 10:30. No, but they'll go at 6 or 7 to the arena. The difference between have to and want to. It gives you energy. People do what they want to do. If somebody doesn't want to do something, they'll give you every excuse under the book why they don't, why it shouldn't work out. But if they want to, they'll have every reason why they should go. Just remember your kids when they were conniving with you and working with you, you know. And what we did, what we do, we still do it as adults. How do you change the shoulds into wants? How do you change those duties in your life into desires? My friends, here's a simple prayer I believe that God will use in your life. God, I'm willing to be made willing. God, I'm willing to be made willing. You see, this makes God your partner. Isn't that great? All powerful, all knowing. Nothing he can't do. God, I'm willing to be made willing. And all of a sudden, you're not alone. You're asking for his help to change your heart. Let me tell you a secret. You can't change your heart anyways. Right. Only God can do that. Right. Only God can change your heart. Whatever you're struggling with, look to God. I'm willing to be made willing. And choose desire over duty. How different our world would be. That's part of being a servant. Secondly, servants choose giving over getting. Peter says in the second part of verse 2, don't be greedy for money, but be eager to serve. In other words, don't ask what I can get, but rather ask, what can I give? Are we more naturally interested in getting or giving? Children learn very quickly about the getting aspect. Part of maturing is learning that you can't always be on the receiving end. You have to be on the giving end as well. Giving has power that we don't recognize sometimes. Getting sometimes seems like the answer. But speak to anyone who has learned this lesson of giving, and the rewards and the satisfaction are far greater than the receiving aspect. Give to others, to see others win, to see others get ahead, to see others being blessed. You can't even quantify that in your life. We live in a world that says me and give to me and I want, and God is saying no, we are a people that are to give of all that we are, of all that we have. Are we more naturally interested in getting or giving? Giving has power that we don't always understand. Getting sometimes is the answer we think, but it's not. And so Peter reminds us here that you don't make a lasting impact on those around us and on our world by what we get. You make a lasting impact by what you give in life. We tend to equate having money with having influence. The psalmist said in Psalm 112, verse 9, he gives generously to the needy, and his kindness never fails. He will be powerful and respected. Influence comes from giving, and it lasts. It's not temporary. Is having wealth and money the problem? No, that's not the problem. You can use wealth and money to give to others, but the problem with the money situation is the greedy part of it. The Bible has a lot to say about money, more than we realize sometimes. It's the greed aspect that's the problem. It's not having it that's the problem. It's wanting more of it, the unquenchable desire to get more that's the problem. And greed keeps us from being satisfied in what you have. When is enough enough? We're always reaching for more. And I think of the little child, the young boy, who goes to the candy jar on the counter, and he puts his hand in there, and he's trying to get as many candy out as he can, but because his fist is clenched so tight and his hand is so full, he can't get it out of the lid. He has to let some go to get it out. And many in our world, and even we as Christians, can get caught up sometimes in this whole get. Money can be deceiving. It looks like you're making an impact when all you're doing is building a bank account. We're encouraged not to confuse influence and income. They are entirely different things. Peter says, instead of focusing on that, be eager to serve. Give. Don't be always about getting. We need to have enough to have a decent life. We need to look after our family and home. But when is enough enough? Servants choose desire over duty. They choose giving over getting. Thirdly, they choose to be an example over being in control. Verse 3, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. Peter's saying, don't be like a ruler ordering people around. Don't be like a ruler over people you're responsible for, but be rather an example to them. You don't make a lasting impact by telling people what to do. You make a lasting impact by showing people how to do it. Amen. Show people how to do it. And wouldn't you agree with me? I think you would. That the world doesn't need more people to tell us what we should do and what we should think and what we should know. It needs more people to show us how to do it. The power to make a real difference is not in our words in ordering others around and telling them. It's in our example, in the life we live. It's showing others what it's like. I'm not saying it's easy, but it's the way it should be done, God's way. You know, I often hear our politicians and other world leaders talk about that we need to travel less and spend less fuel in our flying, and we shouldn't be holidaying so much. And yet as I watch them, they go everywhere in their private jets. All over the place. What example are they giving us? They say one thing and do another. As a parent, do you not remember seeing that sometimes? Maybe catching yourself? You know, don't do as I do, but do as I say. Doesn't work that way. They'll always do as you do. Because our example is what has the power. Our action and behavior has power to influence. As we watch others live their lives following Jesus, it's an encouragement and is showing us how it needs to be done. You know, the word example that is used here in the text is a word that originally comes from the idea of a die or a stamp. Example, you could copy. There's an example. It's something you would use to make an impression on something to match the original. Do we leave a mark on this world? Do each of us, have we left a mark on this world? Our example is what leaves the mark. Do you want to be a great dad, mom, grandparent? Be a great example. You want to be a great citizen? Be a great example. Do you want to be a great Christian? Be a great example. Mahatma Gandhi, the political and spiritual leader in India during their independence movement, commented once about Christianity, and he said, "I like what I see in Jesus Christ. I just don't like what I see in Christians." Jesus is the ultimate example. He's the one we need to look to. He's the one we need to go to and ask to help us to be like himself. You want to be a great Christian, be a great example. Significant living happens with being a servant. But not just being a servant. Peter goes on and he talks about humility. It's about staying humble. In verses 5 and 6, he says, "All of you, clothe yourselves, all of you, clothe yourselves with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time." Humility says, "God, I'm depending on you. I need you in my life." If you stay humble yourself like that, the promise is that he will lift you up in due time. Significance will come to your life because God is going to do the lifting. God is going to do the lifting in your life. He's the one who does the lifting. It's his plan. Will we ever get that as Christians? It's not our plan, it's his plan. It's his will that will be done. It's his will that we pray to be done. What does that mean in your life? What does that look like? You're here for a reason, still in this world, because God still has you part of the plan. Otherwise, he takes you home when it's time. But often we would rather lift up what we want in our time. We want it now. We can't wait. And I'm just as guilty as any of you. I'm very impatient. Ask my Brenda. But we can change and we can learn as we come to the Lord to trust him. Because in due time is his time, and his time is always the right time. Peter learned this from Jesus. In Matthew 23:12, Jesus said, "For whoever exalts himself will be humbled. Whoever humbles himself will be exalted." We humble ourselves by admitting our need of God, by admitting our need of salvation in our life from the sin problem that we have, that we are not able to do it in our own strength, that we need God's help, that we need him, not just in our life, but in our church and in our community, in our country. Humility. Learn to be great at being humble. It sounds like a contradiction, doesn't it? Be great at being humble. It's like the pastor who says, "I've got a great sermon on humility. It's a tremendous sermon." What a humble pastor, eh? And a lot of times we confuse what humility really is. Jesus reminds us here that there's a real connection between our desire to be great and our need to be humble. He's not saying that we shouldn't desire to be great, but the way we get there is through humility. We think that humility is denying my desires for greatness, wiping them out of my heart. And Jesus is saying, no, that's not it. Humble yourself, and I'm going to do the greatness in your life. It has to be my work in you. I will exalt you. Don't give up your ambition. Let humility manage your ambition. That's what Jesus teaches us, that true greatness is depending on God. True greatness is depending on God. And the problem that I see for many Christians is that the more you are blessed with many gifts and talents, it's a danger because you rely on it rather than on God. Do you know what I mean? When someone can do something easily and it comes naturally, and it may even be a giftedness from God, and that's good, but it can become that you trust that rather than in God. There's no better example than Jesus. He not only talked about humility, he showed us humility. In Philippians 2:8, and being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Now think about this for a moment. You know, we pray to God, and we ask God for blessings and good things. But here Jesus humbled himself upon a cross. I read the life story of Watchman Nee, a Chinese Christian prolific writer, who in the end of his life was imprisoned till he died. You see, humility sometimes is trusting God that even in these bad things that happen to you and does not look like it has any value, God will exalt. The cross became everything to the church, to us. Didn't look like it then. And friends, in our life, there are things that happen to seem to be going terribly wrong. We need to trust the Lord in what's happening, that in due time, we will be exalted. Rather than fighting and struggling and arguing and trusting God, accepting. Look at the life of the apostles. All the things that went wrong with them. All the things that went off course. But it was all part of God's plan. It's the same for you and me. It's the same for you and me. Humbly obeying God's leading in your life and depending on God's strength, no matter what comes our way. God is God. He loves you. He made you. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. Significant living. Start by serving. In the church, there's lots of room for service. Many of us have no idea all that it takes to make this happen, even this morning, let alone the church. You're without a pastor right now. You're going to find out a little more of how much it takes. It takes a lot of servants to make it happen. Is that not true? To get a bulletin, to make the lead, to organize, to make things happen, to visit, to pray. All people have to give. But we live in an age, in a world, because I belong to other organizations, and they're all suffering. Nobody wants to do anything anymore. They want everything. They want to go to events, but nobody wants to do the events and all the work of the event, all the setting up, all the cleaning up. Is that not true? And it is even in the church, sadly. Oh, I've done it for many years. I've always done it. I don't need to do it anymore. That's not how it works. It takes a lot of work to make things happen. And the church should be that place where God's people are willing to step forward and step up. We start by serving. And in our service, we remain humble, trusting God, no matter what, how it goes, that he's with us and will lead us, and in due time, will exalt us. My friends, be encouraged. Trust the Lord with all your heart, with all your strength, with all your being. It's the only way. It's the best way. Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this morning. What beautiful songs we've been singing. What a great spirit here today, I pray. I hope that you've challenged us, each and every one, that you speak to us, that we have heard your call to us, that you are a God so great beyond all comprehension, This is your world. Your will be done in it and in our lives too. May we just be a part of it, oh God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Would you mind standing one more time? And after this song, there will be a benediction by Pastor Peter.
Spirit be with and upon each and every one of you. God bless you.